Okay. I'll start. So, we are going to start today on Lie algebras. So let us see how we arrived at this. Okay. We saw that G is a Lie group. Okay. So it is a manifold. Okay. This is being a group. Then G0, the kinetic component identity, is generated by any neighborhood of identity. Okay, this is a group germ. U of E. Okay. So you got the you got Lie group. So you take any E, okay, take the identity. Suppose you take any neighborhood, then within that neighborhood you can clearly put a small disk inside, okay, which we can call the group germ. Okay. By going on multiplying with itself, you will get the whole identity component. Okay. The second is the following. G is compact. Okay. And gamma is a faithful representation . Then I just quoted the theorem by Weil that we can get all IRRs by reducing this gamma tensor, some k times tensor gamma star or gamma bar tensor L m times k, k m belonging to 0, 1. The main thing is that it should be gamma should be faithful. Okay. Then you can take this complex conjugate representation and start reducing. Okay. So what happens is 1 leads to study of what I will call the tangent space at E of G0 and Lie algebras. Okay. Lie algebra is coming exactly because of this reason that this is exactly coming because Lie algebra is coming because of this fact here. Okay. So 2 leads to tensor methods. We can also combine. We can also use Lie algebra techniques leading to study of differential equations, study of certain differential equations. I will not have much well, this is useful. For example, you can get all special functions, the equations governing special functions this way. Okay. I don't know if I have a time, but one and two we should certainly attend to, because they are very of great practical use. Okay. So I want to start with Lie algebra. Okay. So let me so I am going to now focus on Lie algebra methods. What is a Lie algebra? A Lie algebra L is first a vector space. Sorry, I did not start early, but I have not said anything new. First is a vector space, can be real or complex, okay? As let us say situation demands. For example, if you look at even for compact Lie groups are associated to real vector space, real Lie algebras, but you have to use complex techniques to understand it. Okay? So they are not really mutually exclusive. Okay? On which, so is a vector space, okay, called L, Lie algebra L, let me call it L, on which a bilinear composition let me write like this dot okay is defined. Okay. The notation is that you have to put in integer. Okay. Where here this has okay has one anti-symmetry. So you have xy is equal to minus pi x. Of course, it is linear in each factor. So I want, okay. So x and y are in the Lie algebra. Okay. Two fulfills Jacobi identity. So this is x, y, z plus cyclic permutations, okay, plus cyclic 0. Okay. So these are the two defining properties, okay. And I will show you how it comes from a Lie group, okay. At least I will give you the formulae, but we need to look at some examples. Okay. Consider this is a canonical example. All real 3×3 real matrices. Okay. Which are anti-symmetric. So. Okay. Now, three cross is real. Okay. So, as a real vector is L alpha, okay, alpha equal to 1, 2, 3. Now, I will give you what is L alpha. It is a matrix, 3 by 3 matrix, it is minus epsilon alpha ij. Okay. I will tell you what is L1 as a matrix. L1 is, well, L1, 2, 3, okay, what is it? First one, 2, 3 is minus 1, second row, 2, third column is minus 1, etc. L2 will be 2 is 3, 1, 1 minus 1. And L3 is 3 is 1, 2, 1, 2, minus 1, 1. We can see what is a commutator. Let us compute L alpha L beta ij is the two minuses, so is epsilon I alpha I k epsilon beta k j minus I n j anti-symmetrized. Yes, correct. No, I am summing over k. So, k is summed, but this is the third index and the second index. So, I should like this, it is delta beta I delta, what is it? What did I write? I alpha. So, it is delta j alpha minus delta beta alpha delta, sorry, I am getting confused. I should, anti-symmetry is an I and j, so I should write j here, I here and alpha. So this is an anti-symmetric matrix. What is this? I claim that this is equal to epsilon alpha beta gamma L gamma ij. So, this is what I want to prove. This is correct. So, right hand side is epsilon alpha beta gamma minus epsilon gamma ij. So, third place, so it is alpha beta here. It is minus delta I alpha delta j beta minus delta I alpha j delta I beta delta j alpha. Is it correct? What is the answer? Delta beta I delta. Okay. Okay. So the bracket is closed. Okay. So for this, so the so L alpha L beta is epsilon alpha beta gamma L gamma. In quantum mechanics, the spin one angular momentum are j alpha, which is I think my I times minus I, I times L alpha, this is minus I epsilon alpha beta gamma. And you will find j alpha j beta which is I squared is minus 1 times epsilon alpha beta gamma times L gamma is minus I j alpha I squared minus. So it is, so this is your standard I epsilon alpha beta gamma j gamma. This is Spinman angular momentum which is supposed to be self adjoint, Hermitian operators. But notice that there is an I here. So you cannot regard this J's as, if you work with J's, they necessarily belong to a complexification of the angular momentum. So the Hermiticity condition is what requires for you again the reality properties. Okay? Quantum mechanics doesn't care about this, but in people working with Lie algebras use a real form. But notice that J3 or L3 in this mechanic, in this way of doing, is not diagonal because it is like this. Okay? But you know that the eigenvalues of J3 are 1 and minus 1, minus 1 and 0. Okay? So you have to go to the new basis. When you do the new basis, okay, the form of these matrices will change. Even the L's will no longer be real because when you try diagonalizing this matrix, it will become complex. I mean, the diagonalizing matrix is complex. It's a unitary matrix, not a real symmetric matrix. Okay. Okay. Now, a much more striking example is, okay, is the following: the Poisson bracket algebra. Okay, on. Well, I should really say phase space. It's not exactly, or rather, what people call T star Q, Q configuration space. So here, this is an infinite dimensional problem. Okay. Here, we consider if alpha beta are functions on this huge space, T star Q means it is a what they call cotangent bundle. Okay. Phase space is somewhat more general. Okay. But anyway, never mind. So you get a rule for alpha beta is a function defined by, okay, this is alpha beta at QP. If I give you the value of the function, I am done. It is summation d alpha or dqi at QP, well, d beta or dpi minus, well, exchanging alpha and beta evaluated at Q and P. So this is the Poisson bracket of two functions, and we know that it fulfills Jacobi. Okay? So this is an example of an infinite dimensional case, but something you should notice in this thing. In this object, the constant function, if you take one unit, commutes, has zero Poisson bracket with everything. So this is a funny algebra, okay, because it has a set, it has a center. There is something which commutes or has zero Poisson bracket with everything. Okay. So this has the constant function we call it 1, okay, has 0 bracket with all alphas. That is, so alpha 1 is defined by, say, QP is a number 1. So this is number 1, is a function. Then alpha 1 is 0. So it is a 0 function. Okay. So at Q and P is 0. Okay. Now, it is exactly this property, it gets changed when you go into quantum mechanics. Okay. Is that true? Well, let me just think, is that true? No, it's not true. So, okay, this is what you get. Now, the next thing we have to do is the following, okay, the structure constants. By the way, there are other many examples you get in physics where the Lie algebra is infinite dimensional. Okay. Also, mostly we deal with finite dimensions, but in, for example, this thing is infinite dimensional, okay, quite huge. But when you also consider conformal field theories or phase transitions in one dimensional systems, experimentally two dimensional phase transitions, I should say one dimensional, you get this Virasoro algebra, which is infinite dimensional, and it has a classical counterpart, which is also infinite dimensional. Okay. So infinite dimensional things do occur, okay, and most often they cause trouble because the full control is difficult. So let me look at this. Okay. So I will assume that L is, we assume L is finite dimensional. Let E alpha be a basis of L. Then the bracket E alpha E beta by assumption belongs to the Lie algebra. So can expand, so we can expand E alpha E beta, okay, can be expanded as E alpha E beta as some constant C alpha beta gamma E gamma. These are numbers. Okay. So C, this object C gamma alpha beta are the structure constants of L. Okay. These define the Lie algebra. Basically, if you give me this, okay, they have the following two properties, both of which I will tell you how to remember in a minute. Okay. They fulfill one. Antisymmetry that is C gamma alpha beta to minus C gamma beta alpha, and they fulfill Jacobi okay, from this equation E alpha, E beta, E gamma plus cyclic equal to 0. So you write it down, expand this in terms of the C's, get one C, again commute, get some quadratic relation in C's. Okay. Let me write the relation and I will interpret it later. This leads to C gamma, let us see, I should write it in the correct way. Written in with indices is not so easy to remember, but anyway, let me write it. Okay. Yeah, C alpha C mu yeah, if we write the index, second index is, then you have beta gamma delta. Plus again C alpha mu C mu, then you cyclically permute these two indices gamma delta beta plus C alpha C mu, then again you have mu here, then beta, well, right, delta beta gamma. This comes from that equation, and as written as is not very transparent, I would say. Okay. This is like the Bianchi identities. If you have done gravity, there is some identities which are fulfilled by the Riemann tensor. Have you studied some differential geometry? You have, no? So it is the same thing, but written like this, it is not very clear what it means. Okay. So let me interpret, I will interpret for you what this means. For that, let us see the following definition. A representation let me not write it. A homomorphism okay. Let me say isomorphism T from L to another Lie algebra L prime, okay, is a linear map . So is it T from L to L prime, okay, such that Tx commutator with Ty bracket here is T of xy. Isomorphism is the map is 1-to-1. Okay. This is okay. Map 1-to-1. Okay, it is very much like in group theory. This kind of definition is always the same, and it says that this mapping T preserves the structure of the Lie algebras, okay? And it is linear because the L's are linear vector spaces. Okay? Now, interpretation of identity, quadratic identity, on C okay. So let me define okay. Let me use a canonical notation. Add stands for adjoint. Be a map, a linear map from L to linear operators on L. L is a vector space. Okay. So this is like the regular representation. Okay. So defined by so add at on E alpha. This is a linear operator on the vector space itself. So I have to tell you what this is. Right. What this is acting on this basis is equal to, by definition, E alpha E beta. This is linear in these. Okay. So this gives you a mapping of L to linear operators on L. So this is the okay, like the regular representation. Question is add a homomorphism, okay? That is it true that, going back to our definition there, is it true that add E alpha commuted with add E beta, is it equal to add of E alpha E beta? Okay. Is this operator the same as this operator? If it were, add will be a homomorphism from L to a Lie algebra of operators on L. Okay. Let us apply LHS on a basis on E row. Let us just apply it and see what happens. So you will get add E alpha add E beta acting on E row, right. This is equal to add E alpha E beta E row which is equal to, so let me here, there's another term, minus alpha beta exchange. So I should, instead of writing, going on writing, minus alpha beta exchange. Okay. So this is equal to E alpha, E beta, E rho, and that is equal to minus E alpha, yeah, minus alpha beta exchange, E beta, E alpha, E rho. So I want to, I apply, okay, right hand side, okay, RHS on E rho. By the same rule, I am applying that to E rho, so alpha, beta, commutative with E rho. Now, so you can see, okay, now let's say LHS minus RHS is equal to, okay, alpha E beta E rho, okay, from here, and I start E beta plus, okay, E beta E rho, E alpha, by using anti-symmetry. Then I have taken this on the other side with a minus sign, so this will go to the last side, plus E rho, E alpha, E beta, which is 0 by Jacobi. So add is a homomorphism, okay. So add is a homomorphism, okay. In particular, now the matrix of add, say, of, say, add something, let's say E rho, okay, in basis, say E alpha, so let me call this matrix of D rho, D of E rho, is okay, by definition, what? I apply add E alpha, I apply it on the add E rho, I act on the basis, and by definition, I set this equal to E beta, right? Then D rho beta alpha. But this is equal to E rho E alpha. By definition. So this is, let's write C beta rho alpha times E beta. So you find that D rho beta alpha implying the C beta, the structure constant you wrote, rho alpha is simply D rho beta alpha. So the structure constant is some scrambled form, or the matrix, or the adjoint, or the E rho, D of E rho. This is what I call D of E rho. So it is this object. This object is simply the matrix of the adjoint, adjoint under the linear operator representing this E in a basis given where E is. Okay. But the properties of, see, but of course, okay, D is okay, fulfill Jacobi. Because they are just representing the linear operators by matrices. Okay. This is the Jacobian series. We found earlier. So that equation which was not so transparent, it's just this object here. The fact that this add preserves the algebraic structure. Okay. Now one more thing you should notice, okay, that this is important. No. Add A alpha acts like a derivation. That's right. Let's say add of any element on z x derivation, that is differentiation on x y. What do I mean by derivation? You know what it is. It fulfills the chain rule. So what do I mean? That means add z on x y it fulfills the chain rule. Is what? Add z x y plus x and z y. Take differentiation. They say possible bracket fulfills x. So this is again by Jacobi. Okay. Algebras, for example, if you are fond of supersymmetry, this derivation will become a graded derivation. That is, every time this jumps over some integer, which were a what they call an odd object, that is, Grassmann, the odd operator thing, you get an extra minus sign here. So even ones you won't get. So you'll get a graded, you get a graded algebra. This is that algebra is what underlies supersymmetry algebras. Okay. Yeah. Now, definition. Okay. Consider a if a representation let me call it T of Lie algebra L vector space V is a homomorphism from L to linear operators on V, okay, where for the latter D bracket is commutative. Is commutative. Take linear operator. So here, TX, TY. This is simply matrix linear operator bracket is equal to T of XY. But this bracket is different from this bracket. This is a bracket on linear matrices. Right hand side is a bracket on the Lie algebra. So, thus, example, this is perhaps the most important example. The adjoint representation add of L, okay, is the representation on L itself. We saw above. So here add E alpha, add E beta. This is evaluated this as linear operators on L. This equal to add of E alpha E beta. We just evaluated it. We term by term. So this is a So this is the adjoint representation. It the important thing is it exists for all Lie groups. It's like this regular representation of groups, and it is closely related to them. It is not faithful. Okay? The representation is faithful if P is 1-to-1. So example, this add, the representation add may not be fit. For example, okay, the standard example is give representation and if it has something which commutes with everything, it is not faced. The standard example is the Heisenberg algebra. three dimensional. TD, the basis is the same. Q hat and 1, okay, with Q hat, P hat, this is the I 1, etc. This is a quantum mechanical algebra. But it has 1 here. So its adjoint representation, in its adjoint representation, as I indicated, course add 1 is 0. Because it will commute with everything. So it is not faithful. You will take away the 1. Okay. So So let me give another example. Let's say example. This more modest example. Consider the 2x2 traceless anti-Hermitian matrices. With Lie bracket as commutative bracket. A basis is, I'll give you the basis. Minus I sigma alpha over 2, alpha is equal to 1, 2, 3. So let me see, these are Pauli matrices. So let me see what happens. Minus I sigma alpha over 2, minus I sigma beta over 2. This is minus from these two, then the commutator of these two, I epsilon alpha beta gamma sigma gamma over 2. So it is equal to epsilon alpha beta gamma minus I sigma gamma over 2. So the map T from L alpha, the 3 by 3 antisymmetric real matrices, to minus I sigma alpha over 2, which you extend by linearity on all matrices, all antisymmetric matrices going to all anti-Hermitian traceless matrices, is an isomorphism. From 3x3 real antisymmetric matrices to this 2-dimensional 2D algebra. This 2D algebra. To this algebra. It's not 2D, it's 3-dimensional. The last one is spin half angular momentum, okay, which describes spin half. Earlier, at the level of groups, we found that this is not quite true, right? Because we found that when I look at SU2 as a group, it was not isomorphic to SO3 as a group. But at the level of Lie algebras, they are the same. So there is some information being suppressed here. We will see what exactly is the information being suppressed. Okay. When you algebra, I cannot say. If you had if you have done complex, have you done complex variables? No, you have analytic continuation. Have you done the corresponding activity for complex variables? There are a whole lot of things which have the following property. If you know it in a small, some small neighborhood, you can extend it into a global thing, okay? And you recover all properties in a global thing. Okay? Analytic functions are of this nature. Okay? That is why people can even talk about Riemann zeta function zero, because they can. It is only defined a priori. It is only defined. Riemann zeta function is a priori. They are much more strict than groups. Analytic functions have the property that if you know the power series expansion of the group at around any point, that means all the Taylor coefficients of the function at any point, such a way that the power series converges. So you are just given an infinite number of integers, infinite number of numbers, complex numbers, fulfilling the requirement that the power series converges. One can reconstruct the function everywhere. Okay. Not only that, the entire plane, it might have poles, you can tell, you can find these branch cuts, everything can be done. Can you actually do it? Maybe. But there you can easily prove the theorem that this is a fact. Okay? Not easily, but you can prove it. The analog of that result is here. You are given things in the very small neighborhood of the identity of the group, Lie group. You can reconstruct the group globally. Modulo discrete elements, okay, like this. Minus 1 in the case of SU2. Okay. We will see what those discrete elements are, okay, later. So the group properties partake of many of the features of complex variables. Okay. In fact, the source of this fact is in fact exactly that. Okay. Okay. So I'll just make one more remark. Then we will stop for the moment here. The center C of Lie algebra L is a set of all elements C in L such that, okay, C L equal to 0, all L in L. Okay. C is the center. For example, we saw the center. Okay. Example, the Heisenberg algebra. In Heisenberg algebra, the center is, let me use the notation people use, no? C times complex number. You know what this means? 1 and all complex multiples of 1. Okay. So if you regard it as a complex algebra, or you replace C by R. So in that in the adjoint representation, C goes to 0. Okay. We will be I mention this because it comes in this Heisenberg case, okay, and plays a role in the transition from classical to quantum mechanics. Classically, where h bar is 0, the center, that coefficient of 1 that comes in qp equal to I h bar, there is an h bar there. Okay. So at least formally that term will become 0 and the center will disappear. Okay. So it is a non-commutativity of the Heisenberg algebra that characterizes quantum physics. Okay. That is the central point about quantum. So the, I think the all differences between the two theories comes because in one case the algebra you are dealing with, observable algebra, is commutative, namely in classical. In quantum mechanics it is non-commutative, and this is showing up here, so I mentioned this. Okay. So next time, okay, I will quickly recall for you tomorrow things you already know from the case of groups, namely equivalence representations, Schuh's lemma and so forth, but I will simply state them because, for example, Schuh's lemma involves no structure, it only uses irreducibility of representations, not the fact that you are dealing with a group. It's true for algebra, anything, provided you have irreducibility. That concept goes through for all algebras, okay, all sets of operators. So we will quickly go through that, and then we will get down to real business, namely, how does a Lie group give rise to a Lie algebra, and how will I find the Lie algebras? Okay? Practically, if you give me a Lie group, how will I sit down and calculate the Lie algebra? Okay? There are many tricks. Okay? So I will show you the roadway to the tricks, okay, so you can do the computations. Okay? And then we will see how to apply it to concrete problems, namely constructing the representations of Lie groups using Lie algebra techniques. Then we will do tensor methods. Yes, that's what I'll show you.
What came first?
Which came first? No.
So
the chicken egg thing. No. That is not what is you're going to do. What you're interested in is you've got a Lie group G0, and your interest is in finding all its representations, gamma. Okay. So what you're doing here. To jump here, what you go is, you first find out from here what is the Lie algebra. And many times it is much easier to find each representation, it will be called gamma of L. Many times it is much easier to analyze the representations of the Lie algebra. Because it is a real vector space with some small things. You don't have to worry about Euler angles and stuff. Then from here, there are theorems on how to exponentiate this to a representation here. Okay. So we are after this and go how to go from here to there. Okay. Sometimes we lose, say some small information, but you can tell when, provided you find all the representations of the Lie algebra, you are guaranteed to get all representations of the original group. Okay. You won't lose, you start from SU2. Suppose you had started with SU2, find the Lie algebra, and you took only the spin 1 representation, you will only get things without the minus 1. Okay? But if you take all representations, you will get everything. Then you can sort it out, okay, and keep everything. So you can recover all representations that way. So this is what we are after. Okay? Likewise, global way of finding representation would be to find a gamma which is faithful, gamma bar, and I had to give you rules on how to reduce gamma tensor gamma bar and its powers. Okay? So that involves some tensor analysis, some rules of tensor analysis. So we are after representations because they are the ones which come in physics in a heavy way. Okay.